Hello, everyone, and welcome to another episode of Nerdy Movie News Roundup. This is the show where we round up all of the latest news in the world of nerdy movies. We don't have as many things to talk about this week, but still plenty of stuff to discuss, so let's just jump right into it. Why don't we? First up, we got some trailers. We got a trailer for Hellboy the Crooked Man. This is a new Hellboy reboot. They just keep making these movies, don't they? I don't know. They keep on making new ones, and they never really do well, to be honest. But this is a new one. I think it looks fine. It definitely looks lower budget. Like, it definitely looks like they're like, all right, we'll make another one. But since we know it's not going to make any money, we're going to go in, like, a new horror direction. And I think it could be interesting. But it really is going to be all in the execution, because it looks lower budget. It looks like it's going to be a horror movie, and that's, you know, I think the other ones were like more action based, big block special effects blockbuster stuff, like with what Guillermo del Toro was doing and whatnot, whatever the fuck David Harbour was doing. But like, this could be a good direction, but we kind of just have to wait and see. I think this looks just okay though. Next up, we also have a trailer for Cobra Kai Season 6 Part 1. Netflix is back on their bullshit, where they're releasing their seasons for their like biggest shows in parts. I actually don't mind that, because I prefer like week to week episodic television. I think that's just a lot more fun in terms of, you know, everybody being able to discuss every episode and whatnot. So I'm totally fine with this, But yeah, apparently they're splitting it up into three parts, whereas they split up the last season of Stranger Things into two parts. So we'll see. I like Cobra Kai a lot. Every season, I'm like, all right, I think this is probably the time where Cobra Kai is going to get stale or whatever. And then it comes out, and I get like a couple episodes in, and I'm like, hell yeah, I'm back in. I'm like, I don't care. I'm still into this. So this is going to be the last season also. So that's also something that makes me a lot more interested in it. So we'll see. They're going to a tournament or something. That guy's back. He's the villain. All right. Next up, we have a trailer for Kite Man. Hell yeah. So if you don't know, Kite Man was a side character in like the first or the... I can't remember if it was just the first season of Harley Quinn or if it was the first and the second season. Actually, now that I think about it, I think it was just the first season. But he was awesome. He's like this shitty supervillain. And the whole joke is that he's just a guy with a kite, and he really he sucks. But over the course of the season, he became really, like, really endearing, because he's also like super misogynistic or whatever. But he doesn't have like any ill intent within him. You know what I mean? Because he was like dating Ivy. But yeah, he's a really great character. And in my opinion, the last couple seasons of Harley Quinn haven't been the greatest. Like, it's just kind of felt like they haven't known what to do with Harley and Ivy. So I really hope that this is just them being able to spin some new creative gears. And hopefully with this, they can sort of get back to how good the first couple seasons of Harley Quinn was. So yeah, I don't know. I'm optimistic about this one. Yeah, we'll see if it turns out to be any good. All right, next up we have a trailer for Batman Ninja versus Yakuza League. So I guess this is a sequel to that Batman Ninja animated movie that came out a couple years back. I never watched that, but I guess this is a sequel to that, and I guess the Justice League are like the Yakuza or like in the Yakuza or something. And I apparently it's going to be Batman Ninja and Robin fighting the Justice League, but either the Yakuza or something. I don't really understand. It looks kind of interesting. I never got around to watching the first Batman Ninja, so I don't know if this is like a multiverse thing or whatever, or like how they explain everything that's going on here. But we'll see. I might check out Batman Ninja and then this. Although, to be honest, I usually don't watch a lot of the straight to DVD DC animated movies, just because I don't know. I remember there was a stretch where I tried to keep up with them, but they were just not very good, and so I just kind of stopped watching them. So I don't know. I might check out the first Batman Ninja and then this. We shall see. All right, so that's going to be it for all of the trailers. Now let's get into the proper news stories. All right, so first up, Millie Alcock is in Superman, maybe? Question mark? Of course, if you don't remember, Millie Alcock is, of course, she's playing Supergirl. She was also in House of the Dragon, season one. She was great in House of the Dragon as Rhaenyra. So I think she's going to be a great Supergirl. But will she be in Superman? Let's see. So this is a thread where somebody said, Millie Alcock is rumored to be currently in Cleveland for Superman. She was cast as Kara Zor-El for Supergirl Woman of Tomorrow. Now, James Gunn had this to say. Nope. Never has been here unless she's vacationing in the Cleveland or in the CLE and hasn't told me. So here's the thing, right? You might look at this and be like, oh, well, that's that ding ding does it. She's not going to be in Superman. But it just should be noted that it's possible that she was a part of some other shoot. Maybe she's not in Cleveland, but maybe she was in some other area that they were shooting Superman in. I'm assuming they're not shooting the entire thing in Cleveland. So I'm just putting that out there. Like, and it's understandable for somebody to just sort of come to the conclusion of like, oh, well, I guess she's just not in the movie. It's not necessarily true. It is entirely possible that she shows up or that she's already filmed stuff in another area, or maybe she's going to show up to shoot somewhere else. She's just not a part of whatever this Cleveland shoot is. I will say, I feel like she probably should be in Superman. If anything, just to set up her movie, because, you know, the reality is that Supergirl is a lot less popular than Superman. And so I do question the wisdom of potentially having a Superman movie and then just having a Supergirl movie without having her pop up in the movie that everybody's going to go see and get acclimated with her and then potentially get people hyped up for a Supergirl movie, you know, as opposed to just making a Supergirl movie without just like fresh with like, hey, here's a new character, Supergirl. I don't know. You know what I mean? I feel like she probably is going to show up in this, at least in like a post-credit scene or something. But we'll have to wait and see. All right, next story. Will Taylor Swift be in Deadpool 3? So Ryan Reynolds and Taylor Swift and Hugh Jackman and Sean Levy, like they're friends in real life. And I remember it was like I think it was like last year or something where they went to like some sports game or something and they were all hanging out together in real life. And I think these rumors were going on before then, but I feel like that's when it really started of, oh shit, hold up. Is Taylor Swift actually going to be in Deadpool and Wolverine? Now Ryan Reynolds has gone out and done this. So he posted on his Instagram, I guess it was like an Instagram reel or whatever. So I didn't get to see it because it was like one of those Instagram posts that like erase after like 24 hours, but he posted this Instagram reel. It was a picture of him, or of the backside of Deadpool, and apparently one of Taylor Swift's songs, Evermore, it actually says it up on the top. Evermore, it was playing in the background. So this is a very obvious tease of Taylor Swift, and fans noticed that is very similar to, this is the album cover of Evermore. So you can obviously see the similarities here. I mean, come on. It seems pretty clear that Taylor Swift is going to be in this movie. Now, is she going to play Dazzler? You know, that's what everybody's assuming she's going to play. Is she going to play, like, Lady Deadpool or something? Nobody really knows. But I have to imagine at this point that, yes, Taylor Swift is going to be in this movie. I mean, there's been too many, you know, there's been so much smoke, there has to be fire. With this tease here, if Taylor Swift isn't in the movie, then what the hell was the point of that tease? That just seems like you're going to make fans upset for no reason. So at this point, it seems pretty much confirmed that she's going to be in it. All right, next story. We got some more set photos for Superman. So now we got our first looks at Hawkgirl and Guy Gardner. So let's just go through them here. So this is like the zoomed out version of what we were just looking at. We see like Hawkgirl and Mr. Terrific are flying in some kind of contraption here. Not really sure what to make of Mr. Terrific's contraption. I'm going to be honest, I have no idea what's going on there. Like, I don't know if those, like, if, like, the thing that he's sitting on is, like, a part of his costume, or if that's just, like, what they're using to film, and then they're going to CGI that stuff out. I'm not really sure. But I do think the one thing that people are noticing is that there is, like, there's a consistent theme between Hot Girl's outfit and Mr. Terrific's outfit. As well as, if we zoom in here, Guy Gardner's outfit, which there he is. And people also have also been noticing that there's a Lord Tech symbol on all of their outfits. And it seems like, it does seem to be the case that, that a lot of the other superheroes are going to be a part of a team, right? Like Hot Girl and Mr. Terrific and Guy Gardner. At least those three. Well, there are probably going to be other heroes that are part of that same team. And it seems like they're maybe going to be working for Maxwell Lord, right? That seems to be the theory here. And I think that's very interesting, because it seems like what they're kind of setting up here is that they're going to be like corporate superheroes, I guess, kind of like maybe what we see in The Boys, although I'm sure that these guys aren't going to be as awful as the heroes in The Boys. But it seems like they're maybe going to be morally compromised in some way, or they're going to be being used for ill purposes. And then Superman is going to be a hero that's very independent and on his own. And I'm sure he's going to be like, that's going to be a part of the story. It's going to be the struggle between Superman and these like corporate superheroes. That kind of seems what they're aiming for. And I think that actually sounds kind of interesting. But yeah, if we look back at Guy Gardner, yeah, like he's wearing a jacket a lot like the other guys, and he has like a little lantern thing on his belt. I guess the only thing that I would wonder is that isn't Guy Gardner like working with the Lantern Corps, like the space cop organization? Do they not have a problem with him also working for Maxwell Lord? I don't know. Maybe they just wouldn't care. He's like, I don't care as long as you're keeping Sector whatever safe, we don't really care. So that's kind of interesting. Here we also have another picture of what seems to be Superman, like, holding some child or whatever. That's kind of interesting. Here we also have, like, the side of Guy Gardner. He also has another lantern thing on his sleeve. Yeah, there's more Hot Girl. Yeah, let me see a Superman holding a child. Is this like an actual part of a scene, or is this just David Cornsweet playing with some kid? Not really sure, to be completely honest with you. But I mean, it wouldn't surprise me at all if there was if there is a point in the movie where Superman picks up a child. I mean, that makes a lot of sense. And then here we have like the front of Hot Girl's outfit. I mean, yeah, that's the thing. I know people have been shitting on these outfits because it's obviously a lot different from their comic book counterpart. But I mean, for me, I'm not a guy that in general cares about outfits, but I can definitely understand where this criticism comes from a lot more than a lot of other superhero suit criticisms, because these just straight up aren't the outfits from their comic books. But I think that if there does end up being that story reason of that they're Maxwell Lord, like, sponsored superheroes, I'm fine with it, because I would assume that there's going to be some arc where they're going to be these like corporate sponsored superheroes, and then Superman is going to inspire everybody and expose Maxwell Lord for being a bad guy and whatever. I assume that that would be all a part of the story. So I'm not too worried about it at this point. I think James Gunn has a plan for how he's going to handle all of that. But yeah, those are the new pictures. We shall see how it all turns out. All right, last story of the day. The Netflix Horizon Zero Dawn series has been canceled. So this is coming from Rolling Stone. The streamer announced in 2022 that Blackman would spearhead the adaptation of the popular video game Horizon Zero Dawn and create the original outer space thriller series Orbital as part of that deal. Rolling Stone has learned that the two projects are no longer moving forward. So, first of all, I'm actually a pretty big fan of Horizon Zero Dawn. I really love the first game. I'm actually currently playing through the second game right now. as this news came out, I've been playing through the second game. And if you've never played these games, they're basically like post-apocalyptic games where they take place in America in a post-apocalyptic setting. But I think what makes the series kind of unique is that you play as like the humans that currently live on Earth, and but like humanity has like reverted to the point where they're like almost indigenous, where they're not technologically like super technologically advanced. But you know that like they're using bow and arrows and stuff like that, and they're using like native, they look like Native Americans and whatnot. Their cultures operate a lot like Native American cultures. But you know you're in a sci-fi setting because the world is littered with like robot dinosaurs. And so the gameplay of the game is you're using like a bow and arrow, and there is some like they are like they use technology and whatnot to like craft their weaponry that actually like allows them to take out the robot dinosaurs. But yeah, you play as Aloy, who's this character. And yeah, like she uses a bow and arrow and she takes out robot dinosaurs, and it's a lot of fun. I mean, the gameplay is super fun, but the story is also really good because it's like the world building is fascinating because you also see like landmarks and like buildings that are worn down and overgrown by like vegetation and stuff like that. So it's really cool the way that you like sort of slowly realize that you're in a post-apocalyptic setting. And the whole point of the games are just like sort of discovering like what exactly happened here. Why, like, what happened to civilization? Why has it reverted? Where, you know, who made these dinosaurs? Why, like, what are they doing? And or like what were they trying to do? Sorry, what were they trying to do? And it's a really great game, and I think it could adapt well to like a movie or a TV show. But so then we get into this Rolling Stone article. So I took that excerpt out of the Rolling Stone article. That was a part of a much larger piece that was specifically talking about that about the showrunner Steve Blackman. And the Rolling Stone article is a big expose about how apparently he has created like a toxic work environment on his shows, and that obviously sucks. It's very much one of those things where like people are saying stuff about him, he's denying it. That being said, there are like a good amount of people that are coming out against him, so it seems like there's probably some truth to the allegations. So, you know, if he's like a toxic abusive boss or whatever, then probably for the best that his shows don't move forward. But, you know, he's the showrunner of Umbrella Academy, which is a very successful show. So I'd be lying if I said I wouldn't have been interested to see what he would do with Horizon Zero Dawn, even though I haven't personally watched Umbrella Academy. But I just know people say it's really good. So that is disappointing on that front. But I mean, listen, if you're an asshole, then you probably shouldn't be. you should probably face repercussions for that. So I understand that. The main thing to note, though, is that it says that Rolling Stone has learned that the two projects are no longer moving forward. Now, the big question is, are they no longer moving forward? Like, when they say those two projects are moving forward, does it mean that the projects that Blackman was working on aren't moving forward, and that Sony may still be interested in adapting Horizon Zero Dawn, and maybe they'll go out and get another showrunner or something, or maybe they'll shop it to another streamer? I mean, that's possible. You know, we don't really know. You would assume so. I that's the thing. Sony is so interested in their like transmedia stuff. You have to imagine that they want to make a Horizon show, because with the success of the Uncharted movie and The Last of Us and to some degree Twisted Metal, you would assume that they would definitely be moving forward with Horizon. You know, they're also making a God of War Amazon series. If I'm being honest, though, I actually don't think that Horizon would be best on TV. I think if you're going to make a Horizon thing, it should probably be a movie, because you would want, like, this is a show, it's a game where you're fighting robot dinosaurs. You kind of want to do that on the big screen. Like, I would want to see that on the big screen. I would also, like, in terms of the budget, like, that's kind of something that you kind of have to do on a big in a movie. It would be kind of hard to do that on a show, you know? So honestly, if for anything, like, for that reason, I could see that project being canceled because of that reason. And maybe they're transitioning to a movie. That being said, it could also just be that the Blackman guy, you know, is getting canceled and his work environment was being exposed and Sony didn't want anything to do with that, or Netflix didn't want anything to do with that, so they didn't want to start up new projects with him. I mean, that's possible. So we'll see. But yeah, as of right now, the Rolling Stone is reporting that the show is canceled. So we'll just have to wait and see what happens. All right, next up. I watched House of the Dragon Season 2, Episode 4. Or sorry, no, Episode 3. Yeah, we're on Episode 3. this was another solid episode. The one thing that I will say about House of the Dragon at the moment is that I'm kind of getting a little antsy. I'm like, okay, let's get to the war. You know what I mean? We're doing a lot of yipping, yipper-yappering, you know? Like, Rhaenyra in this episode is all like, we don't need to shed blood. I can stop this. I can meet up with, what's her face again? Elizabeth? What's the name? The lady from the green team. I'm forgetting her name. I can meet up with her and we can talk this through. It's like, what are you talking about? You're going to war. That's what's happening. Like, what are we doing? So, I do hope that next episode is just the all-out war begins. Like, we're at that point. We need to stop talking about it and just start doing it. At least I feel like. But at the end of the day, it's not like the episode was bad. It was still very engaging and well-written and whatnot. But that is the one thing that I will just note. all right. I also watched My Adventures with Superman Episode 7. This was great. I really like the show. Yeah, sorry. Sorry, I had to go deal with something. My Adventures with Superman, Season 2, Episode 7, it was very good. This was very much like a Lois and Jimmy-focused episode. Clark and Kara weren't even in it. But yeah, I really liked seeing Clark and Lois and Jimmy going on an adventure. Really like seeing Lois, you know, kind of feeling guilty about how she handled things with Clark. You know, you got the relationship drama stuff that obviously has to be a part of the show. I also like seeing Jimmy almost like having the same values as Clark. I actually really liked that. Like, and even in the last episode, I remember Clark talking about how, or no, it was in this episode, he talks about how they can help Kara because Clark had him and he had his parents and he had people to support him. And it actually kind of interesting that they're kind of implying that Jimmy, a lot like his dad, along with Clark's parents, actually probably played a role in molding Clark into being the hero that he is, which I think is kind of fascinating, you know? But yeah, like, I liked how Jimmy had very much of a, hey, we can do this without hurting people approach, which I thought was very cute. I also, you know, I also like Livewire. She came back and she was a pretty cool character as well. I like that they bring back the gorilla and the brain characters, the French guys. They were pretty cute too. So yeah, very cute episode. I really love the show, man. It's so good. Like, I haven't been doing episodic reviews on the channel just because I decided to start reviewing shows episode by episode and doing individual videos for them, like, too late into this season. And I was like, okay, well, I'll just review the entire season. I'll do a dedicated video to it once the season is over. But man, I'm really loving it so far. So definitely recommend it if you're not checking it out already. Next up, I watched episodes 2 through 4 of Suicide Squad Isekai. So if you don't know, they are doing a Suicide Squad anime. My main problem with the show is that I didn't know what an isekai was. So when I start watching the show in the first episode, I was like really into it. I was like, oh yeah, I really like this anime adaptation of the DC world. And then the Suicide Squad, they get sent into this fantasy world, and it's just like, oh, so this is just generic anime land? Why are we here? And then I didn't realize that isekai is like an entire genre of anime where the characters get sent to a fantasy land. So I just wasn't expecting that. And I was actually like really interested in seeing an anime adaptation of the DC world, which is actually, it looks like that's what Batman Ninja versus Yakuza League is going to be. So I don't know. Like, I still like it. I like the Suicide Squad and I like the characters, but I'm into episode 4 and it's just the world that they're in is just the generic fantasy anime world. And like, I kind of don't care about any of the generic fantasy anime characters. So that's just my one beef with the show, but I like the characters. I think the show is pretty fun and funny. And I will say, though, the last episode, like episodes 3 and 4, they kind of like repeat the same thing where they literally like go and do a military operation to kill the rat catcher in episode 3. And then they just do that same thing in episode 4. So I hope in episode 5, the plot also picks up and they actually like get to more interesting things. So the show's okay so far. Like, if you're into anime and you like the idea of watching a Suicide Squad anime, that is what this is. There are a lot of anime tropes. If you're somebody that's not really into anime, then you just know that this is an anime first before being like a TV show in a lot of ways. Before being a DC thing in a lot of ways. Like, they are taking these DC characters and they are putting them into an anime. So there are a lot of anime tropes that you might find annoying, but I'm enjoying it so far. All right. Next up, I watched The Acolyte episode 6, and I'm officially at the point with The Acolyte where I can pretty safely say that it's just underwhelming. Like, I don't hate it, you know? I don't think it's the worst Star Wars show by a mile, you know? I think there are better shows, right? Andor. Not nearly as good as Andor. But I don't think it's nearly as bad as, like, The Book of Boba Fett, for example. So, I find The Acolyte to just be very underwhelming, though, because we're at the point with episode 6 where it's like, okay, so you're telling me that at the end of the day, when we're looking at the plot of the show, it literally is just the Sith guy wanted an acolyte. And because of that, and because the Acolyte character wanted to get revenge on the Sith, or not on the Sith, on the Jedi, that's why they killed her, or that's why they were killing Jedi. That's not a very interesting plot, you know? Or it could be, except for the fact that we're not nearly as invested in these characters to really care. Like, at the end of the day, it is a very personal story between, like, 4 characters. And we just don't care enough about these characters for that to be compelling. And that's just where I'm at with episode 6, where I'm like, this is fine, I'm not hating it, but it just needs to be more... I really wish I cared more about these characters in order to really feel anything when it comes to this story and this narrative. So, like, we'll see if they can pull out something, like, super interesting in the next 2 episodes, but I kind of don't think they will, so we'll see. Alright, last thing we're going to talk about today... I watched The Boys season 4 episode 6. So, yeah, this was a pretty rough episode. At least just in terms of what happened. I actually thought it was very good, but man, they put Huey through the ringer. I mean, he basically gets sexually assaulted, right? Like, technically he consented to it, but oof, like that was a very rough thing that like it was very rough to watch. This episode. But overall, I mean, it's still very good and very well written. Like, everything that they did with Homelander and Sister Sage and Firecracker, like, all the dynamics there of Homelander being this very, like, fascistic character, but at the same time being too stupid to really be like a ruler, and then he, like, needed he like needed Sage and Victoria Newman to actually like come in and help him explain the whole thing, and seeing Victoria Newman kind of step up and do what she needed to do, which is convince all the politicians and all the billionaires, but that obviously bothering Homelander that he's not capable of doing that. I thought that was all very interesting. Firecracker also kind of making me feel bad for her. You know, she's this like, you know, white trash sort of character. I'm sorry, I don't mean that in an offensive way or anything, but you know, that's just what she is. And seeing how she doesn't really fit in with these people, I thought was actually kind of an interesting moment of making me feel bad for this character who's objectively, you know, a terrible person, which The Boys is very good at doing. And yeah, and then everything that they're doing with Butcher as well is very fascinating. Like, I'd heard the fan theory that Jeffrey Dean Morgan was like all in his head or whatever, and it very much is what's going on here, you know. And I think that's very interesting that Butcher is. I'm assuming that I feel like Butcher is just going to end up breaking bad. I don't think there's going to be a good ending for Butcher where he's going to do the right thing. I think he is going to develop the. I think he is going to end up developing the poison. And I think that is how this show is going to sort of lean into an X-Men sort of direction where it is going to be humans versus superheroes. I mean, I just feels like that's the direction that they're going in, and I assume that it's not going to stop. So I think everything that they're doing with that is very interesting as well. But yeah, honestly, what they did with Huey, and that this is saying a lot. One of the more effed up things that they've done, because it's also just the fact that they showed so much of it. It was very, very disturbing to watch. But yeah. And yeah, the Huey's reaction when they were back at the base with Starlight was also heartbreaking. So yeah, very good episode, but one of the more like rough ones to watch, in my opinion, even though there's been a lot of effed up stuff in the show. But yeah, let me know what you think in the comments down below, and I'll see you in the next video. Goodbye.